industrial revolution overthrew a corrupt dictatorship, but its Marxist leanings alienated Cuba's middle class. And that alienation led to one of the world's largest political exodus of children in history. The clandestine program was run by a Catholic priest and financed in part by the U.S. government. It was known as Operation Pedro Pan. It's a joyful fall afternoon here at the Hacienda Don Francisco Ranch in Acton, California. Dancing, laughter, prayers of gratitude.
We give thanks, dear God, for...
A far cry from the event over 40 years ago that bombs these people today. They are known as Pedro Pans, and 50 of them are here at the ranch. Oscar Pichardo, who is a Pedro Pan himself, is one of the organizers.
When you say Pedro Pan, I mean, you know, when I say I'm a Pedro Pan, I tell it to another Pedro Pan, we know we have this bond that makes us fraternal. It's like I feel like they're all my brothers and sisters, and when we reunite, it's a very deep emotional moment, especially when we meet for the first time.
I think that experience of being sent away, having to become old, young, independent, young, made us stronger and shaped us in many ways.
For 20 months between December of 1960 and October of 1962, over 14,000 young Cuban children arrived in the United States without their families. It was called Operation Pedro Pan. Their parents sent their children to the U.S. to escape the Marxist-Leninist indoctrination the then new Castro regime was forcing on Cuban society.
And I remember looking at the mirror that night, and that's when I burst into tears because I knew I was here alone and there was no turning back.
The exodus was sponsored by the Catholic Welfare Bureau, and the U.S. waived visa requirements for children aged 2 to 17. They arrived on flights from Havana to Miami and then dispersed to over 100 cities in 35 states, mostly to foster homes, orphanages, and schools. The plan was they would reunite with their families if and when they could follow the children to the U.S.
We were going to school at a Catholic school, so during the Bay of Pigs, all the nuns and priests were expelled from Cuba. So they closed all the schools, and all the people that were going to the public school through the government were being sent to camps to cut sugarcane. And the families would be separated, and my family didn't want to do that.
Stella Bueno was 15 years old when she left Cuba. She waited 3 months in an orphanage in Florida before arriving on the first flight of Pedro Pan orphans to California.
We thought it wasn't going to last too long, and the government would only allow us to live with 2 change of clothing, 1 pair of shoes, no towels, no nothing, and no money, of course, no jewelry or anything that we could sell and get money for it.
Yes.
Francisco Fairmont was 11 years old when he became a Pedro Pan.
I was one of many who ended up in an orphanage in Denver, Colorado, until my parents finally came. And it was a crummy experience, but it was also the world's greatest crash course in the English language.
The Pedro Pan children lived as orphans until their families came for them.
It was very traumatic for the parents to take their children anywhere from 2 to 14 years of age and ship them to a foreign country. Basically, there was a promise, we'll take care of your children. Who are you going to take care of your children? Where? How? How are they going to be housed, cared for? None of those specific answers were provided. Parents, in faith and in terror of the Cuban regime, sent 14,000 kids abroad.
These Pedro Pan refer to themselves as Cuban Americans. As one put it, you rarely see a Cuban flag without the American one. For most, if they went back to Cuba, it would solely be a visit to their homeland, and then only after Castro dies.
We, who were in deep trouble in Cuba, were welcomed by the United States and given these opportunities of pursuing life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
I will never go back until the whole government is out.
Why?
They took everything from my life. They took my youth away, and I don't want to give them 1 cent of my hard-earned money in here.
Coming up, we take a look at one of the most successful Cuban-American families in the U.S. In the 40 years they've lived in Vernon, California, they've built a $90 million business. Now, many Cubans have achieved economic success that's been less common among other Latino immigrants. We asked the popular Ask a Mexican columnist Gustavo Arellano to analyze why.
I think where Cubans are different is that a lot of them, at least the first wave of immigrants, they were professionals, so they already had that step up, whereas a lot of immigrants from Mexico and Central America, they're peasants, so they're going to be poorer people. You view the second wave of Cuban immigrants, the Marielitos and the poorer immigrants themselves, they're in the same condition, basically, as Mexican immigrants and Central American immigrants here. You're at the same place where it's harder for them to assimilate, whereas the first generation of Cubans, they just jump into it immediately.